Welcome to Slash Christian Church online worship for Sunday, May 31st, 2020. I'm Reverend Michael Weeks coming to you from our sanctuary in Ashland, Virginia on this Pentecost Sunday. Pentecost we remember as the birth of the church and the coming of the Holy Spirit, symbolized in our sanctuary today by the colors red, by the dove, which represented God's Spirit coming to be among the people who were gathered there in the story in Acts 2. Other symbols in our sanctuary include fire, symbolizing the Spirit moving among the people, the flames that we have above the cross on the pyramids on our table. I remember being a teaching assistant in seminary, helping first-year students who were learning about the Holy Spirit. And we were talking about two words, a Greek word and a Hebrew word. Those words representing the Spirit were ruach and pneuma. It seems ironic to me, and good, actually, that we are reclaiming the breath of God during this season of the quarantine and pandemic, as this disease takes away our breath. So we are once again claiming the pneuma, the breath of God. Those are wonderful ways that we come together to celebrate without fear, knowing that there is hope, that people are working hard right now to help us so we can get back to worshiping in our sanctuary soon. Our members received the Slash report this weekend, which outlines the elders' carefully thought out plans for reopening the sanctuary for worship. This will happen once the number of cases of COVID-19 goes down here in Hanover County for 14 days in a row. And we hope that it will be very, very soon. We all look forward to worshiping together again, but from your calls and emails and texts, I know, we all know, that there's a lot of participation in online worship. I sure hope the children are enjoying the kid videos and the children worship and wonder that we are sending out each week and that are located on our YouTube channel. We make these special for the kids every week. Connect with us this week on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, on the phone, or join us for coffee or dessert in the Zoom room. Take a picture of your family today watching worship, wearing red to symbolize Pentecost, and text those or email those to me. I'll look forward to seeing how everyone is watching and where everyone is watching from. As we get set to begin worship, I invite you to participate with us today by singing along, taking communion, and reading our scripture. Welcome to Slash Christian Church.
Lord God Almighty, Would you pray with me? Beloved God, let the Spirit descend upon us like a dove, bringing peace to unite the world. Let the Spirit come like a breath, bringing life to renew all the people of God. Then let the Spirit spread like fire, bringing energy to those who bear witness to your love. Spirit of the living God, fall upon us. Melt us, mold us, fill us, use us. Let the Spirit fill us as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Hello, I am Anna Olivo. Welcome to / Church Online. You're invited to join our congregation in collecting food for Ashland Christian Emergency Services this month, benefiting many in Ashland who have lost their jobs and are in need of some help during this quarantine. A list of items needed is here and was in your Sunday email. A plastic tub will be outside the office Monday to Thursday, 9 a.m. to noon. For you to drop off. You can also make a cash donation to ACES by mailing your check or using Engage Online Giving. Now take a look at our Zoom room schedule for this week. Coffee and prayer Monday, elders meeting Tuesday, youth meeting on Wednesday, and dessert and prayer on Thursday. Please make a note of those times and days to connect with our other members at / One of the things we've been talking about lately in worship is that the kingdom of God is not just a place we go into the next life, but it's a place that comes near to us in the life that we live, love, and serve one another following the example of the Gospels. Starting today and for the next 4 weeks, we're going to explore something you may not have thought about. Did you know by examining some of the statements Jesus made about the kingdom, we can come up with the gospel for the kingdom of God? Yes, the gospel for the kingdom of God will help us fully understand Jesus' teachings. Reverend Michael begins the series in a moment. Right now, I invite you to take some time to prepare for communion. Bread and juice or whatever you have available. Open your Bibles and read Matthew 6:10 and 6:33. Pause the video while you read.
So what is the gospel of the kingdom of God? I know what you're thinking. I know the gospel. I've heard the gospel. I've accepted the gospel. That's great. Because together we're about to discuss that this good news is even better than we thought. This good news gives us a vision of how to live our lives day by day. This gospel of the kingdom of God not only saves us and gives us a ticket to heaven, it's also God's radical plan to change lives, to change the world right now. The kingdom vision of Jesus helps God to come and live inside each of us. The kingdom is God's way of making the world more just and fairer for all of creation. Today, let's take a look at how Jesus understood and preached the gospel. We'll examine biblical texts from all four Gospels to discover how deep and radical the good news Jesus proclaimed really was. Next week, we'll discover how the Gospel presents the very real possibility of a life change for us right here, right now, even before we go to heaven in the next life. And in week three, we'll look at how the Gospel of the Kingdom of God was originally revealed in the Old Testament. And finally, in the fourth week, we'll learn that the gospel presents a grand picture of a wonderful future. By the end of our time together, we will see that the gospel is a more practical and more life-changing thing than we could have ever imagined. The first four books of the New Testament are Matthew, Mark comes next in our pulpit Bible, Luke, and then John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the first four books of the Bible.
They tell us about the life and teachings of Jesus.
Each gospel also describes Jesus' death and resurrection. And we call these books gospels because they contain the good news about Jesus. That's what gospel means, good news. But what exactly is this good news? It's communicated in this phrase, the kingdom of God is near. John the Baptist preached that the kingdom of God was near in Matthew 3. Jesus began his ministry with that message as well. The text from Mark 1 says, after John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. You know, Jesus characterized his ministry using this kind of language also in Luke's gospel. He said, I must proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns because that's why I was sent. And so he went and preached in other towns besides Galilee. So you can see that in each of these gospels, the good news is the proclamation that God's kingdom has come near to people. Other translations of the Bible you might have read this morning might say the kingdom of God is at hand, or the kingdom of God is breaking in. Jesus was announcing that God's reign was coming close. In other words, it was previously far away, but now it was coming near. So what is this kingdom of God all about? Early in his ministry, Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount, and he mentioned God's kingdom 8 times in that sermon. Let's look at just 2 examples from the sermon. The first will sound very familiar to you. You said these words a few minutes ago when you recited the Lord's Prayer. Let your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Matthew 6:10. Jesus instructed his disciples to pray for the coming of God's kingdom, and then he explained what it would look like. God's will being done on earth as it is in heaven. That is so important. Jesus is telling us that God's kingdom is not a physical kingdom. It does not have political boundaries or borders. It is not found in one single location, but is found wherever God's will is done on earth, just as it is in heaven. Now let's try to imagine how God's will is done in heaven. Do you think that in heaven people lie to one another? Or hurt one another? Do you think that in heaven people are afraid about their future? No, because God rules in heaven with peace and harmony. There is no fear or anxiety about who is in control. God is. Part of the good news from Jesus is that it is possible to live here on earth in peace and harmony and free from fear or anxiety. Wouldn't that be great for us in a time like this during quarantine? Jesus is instructing his disciples to pray that this kingdom on earth will become real. This is very important. Some people think that this part of the Lord's Prayer is simply like praying for world peace, and the rest of the Lord's Prayer is for our everyday lives, like give us our daily bread, forgive us our sins, lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Of course, we should pray for world peace. It's a good thing. But Jesus is instructing his followers to pray that God's kingdom would become an everyday reality in their lives. Let's look at another mention of God's kingdom in the Sermon on the Mount. It's in Matthew 6:33. Jesus tells us we should not worry about what we will eat or drink, nor should we worry about what we will wear, but we should seek first God's kingdom and his righteousness, and everything else will take care of itself. He says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. By looking at these 2 verses together, we can see that Jesus instructs us to pray fervently for God's kingdom to become a reality in our lives, and that God's kingdom should be our highest priority. Jesus mentions God's kingdom 120 times in the gospel. There is certainly a gospel of the kingdom of God. Jesus tells us that the gateway to the kingdom is by changing your life and living more like God. He talks about this metaphorically by saying, you know, first you have to be born again in the waters of baptism, and then you can become a part of the kingdom when you turn your life around. You know, we live in God's kingdom, which has no borders and no boundaries. It is not political or social. It is about God's will being done God's way among God's people. The result is righteousness, peace, and joy, according to Paul, who wrote to the church in Romans in chapter 14. God's kingdom brings the peace and order of heaven into our everyday lives. Who doesn't want peace? But the way to peace, real peace, is new birth in Jesus Christ. It's the starting point. The reason why the good news is better than we first thought is that the new birth opens the possibility of living in God's kingdom here and now, as well as after we die and go to heaven. The gospel is also about learning a new way to live, God's way, and the result of living in God's kingdom is that a little bit of heaven begins to break into our everyday lives, here and now. That's why Jesus began his ministry by saying, "The kingdom of heaven is near," or another translation, "The kingdom of heaven is close at hand." He wasn't trying to say God's kingdom was going to take over the earth once and for all. He was saying that God's kingdom finds its home in the hearts of God's people if we will only receive him through being reborn and learning to live like he lived. Do you think that God will force us to wait until we've died in order to receive the benefits of becoming God's children? Not at all. First, his grace gives us the assurance of life in heaven, and then that same grace works the life of heaven into our lives day by day. Now that we have explored the gospel of the kingdom of God and how it was central to the good news Jesus preached, I want to make two things clear. First of all, we should not confuse the kingdom of God with heaven. God's kingdom includes heaven, of course, but God's kingdom is so much larger. Remember, the kingdom of God is anywhere that God's will is being done God's way. It's where the king has dominion. That's how we get the word kingdom. It is a combination of two words, king and dominion. So it's true that God rules in heaven, but he also rules in the hearts of his people. That is an important distinction, because if we think the kingdom of God means only heaven, we will think that everything Jesus said about the gospel of the kingdom is for some future time after we die. But Jesus said that God's kingdom is breaking into the here and now, or at least beginning to. So the kingdom is more than heaven. Second, the kingdom of God is not the same thing as the church, because churches can be imperfect and people in churches can make mistakes. But instead, just remember, the kingdom is anywhere where God's will is done in the hearts of God's people. That means the kingdom can be right there in you, under quarantine, or anytime you share God's love with others. In fact, the kingdom cannot just be in a church. It has to be the people leaving the church to build the kingdom in the world. We will never change the world by going to church. We will only change the world by being the church. This great kingdom, not heaven and not just the church, is what we will study in the coming weeks. God's kingdom is not owned by any one culture or any one denomination. God's kingdom exists wherever Jesus the King has dominion in the hearts and minds and lives of his followers. It means that the kingdom of God can sneak in anywhere, can operate in any place, and that's good news too. I invite you to join me on this journey of discovery and building God's kingdom in our lives. Amen. Amen. Let us pray together. God, on this Sunday, when we remember the beginning of the church and the coming of the Holy Spirit, we ask you, O God, to fill us with your breath, fill us with your wind, fill us with your spirit. In the trying times we're living in, God, we have fear. We are afraid. So we ask you to instill in us your spirit to create the kingdom in all of our relationships with people we meet. Help us find ways to serve humankind. Help us to be your hands and feet and to love as you loved. So many names are on our hearts today. People who have suffered loss, people who are sick, people who need your strength, O God. Send your healing touch upon them. be gracious to them and grant them your peace, your justice, your fairness, O God. Let it roll down like a beautiful river. We remember the beginning of the church as we celebrate its birth today and the coming of your Spirit. Again, God, instill in us that Spirit to live, to love, and serve in the world. Amen.
To rejoice, exalt, revel.
To celebrate the many memorable moments of life, large and small.
Perhaps with voices raised in song.
Or hearts exploding with excitement.
Or family and friends drawn to a holiday table to raise a toast.
But how do we celebrate a truly world-changing, life-altering milestone?
Such as the welcoming of more than 1,000 new churches into the family of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ.
Since 2001, this has been the goal of the 2020 vision.
And we reached and exceeded our goal ahead of schedule through the new church movement.
Thanks to nurturing disciples like you and your generous support of the Pentecost offering.
Each year, half of this special offering stays in your local region or area to plant and nourish new churches.
The other half is used throughout the United States and Canada by New Church Ministry to train, equip, and assist church leaders at events like Leadership Academy.
Imagine more than 1,000 new and affiliating faith communities in just 20 years, living into the teachings of Jesus Christ. By welcoming the homeless,
feeding the hungry,
teaching the young,
and transforming their communities through hands-on mission and ministry.
And know that this is just the beginning.
More than 1,000 new churches and counting. Celebrate them and our faith with your continued support of the Pentecost offering and the new church movement.
So that more disciples will be drawn to our family table,
where all are welcome
and their places are waiting.
Your special gifts this week and next week to the Pentecost offering will help us grow new churches where new people will get the word of Jesus' kingdom vision and will make the kingdom come even nearer to more people in the world. That is exactly what Jesus was preaching and teaching about in the Gospels. Thank you for your gifts and for your faithful regular giving to Slash Church. You've been mailing checks, and many of you have been using online giving. Thank you. Let us pray. Wind who makes all winds that blow, we rejoice as we present these gifts to you. You fill us with the breath of life, and we give thanks, knowing all we are and all we have are yours alone. So we pray that you will renew the life we've lost, inspire us to greater generosity even as you accept these gifts on this Pentecost day. Breathe your Spirit into what we give and into us. Use what we've offered and use each of us. Multiply these gifts that they might be used to blow through the whole world, bringing peace and justice through the power of God. Amen.
Come to the fountain. is a look backwards in remembrance of the death of Jesus Christ for our sins. It's a look at the present of sharing communion with the living Christ, and a look to the future in the promise of eternal life in the presence of God. Jesus invites us to this table to share in this meal with Him. Let us pray.
Our Father, on this Pentecost Sunday, we gather about the table that you first gathered with your disciples to celebrate the birthday of the church, to celebrate the present church in the world in which we live. And we gather to share these elements that you have given us, of bread and cup, to remember and to share and to move forward. We thank you for this opportunity to be a part of your church and to share in this experience today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
On the night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, he took the cup and said, "This is my blood poured out for you and represents the new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus taught us to pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven." When we pray and seek the kingdom of God, we're also seeking Jesus to be in our hearts every day. This week, reach out and share the love of Jesus with your neighbor. Amen.
Jesus, would I know more of His grace to others show, more of His saving fullness see, more of His love who died for me, more about Jesus.
Carry the flame of Pentecost out into the world so that God's kingdom can come even nearer to everyone we meet. Amen.
Blessed be your name.